Dragan je sad prihvatio, prošli smo i Balavarti i sada dolazimo na Novoprenje. Znači danas ćemo proučiti dio, zadnji dio iz Manuela Kadambini koji opisuje zadnji prenje. Također bi vas obavijestio da u 11.30 ćemo imati još jednu sastanak za Manuela, znači još jednu mogućnost gdje možemo postavljati pitanja i odgovore. Znači sve nedoumice koje možda imamo vezano za ovu temu, sa ovog seminara, još možemo postaviti pitanja od 11.30, naravno ako imamo i drugih tema. Još jedna tehnička informacija, svi vi koji su došli ovdje i kao gosti želite naknadu za smještaj i prasada, to možete učiniti tako da priđete meni ili viđe nakon terapiju. Ali više.
I'm gonna go get some more. and ultimately prema. So we did the first eight, and now we're talking about prema. This is the last one. And Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur speaks mostly on this particular topic. I guess I was thinking, why did he put so much emphasis on the love of God on one stage, which is pretty much a rare stage for people to reach. But I was thinking because he's on that platform, and therefore he was talking about his own realizations in Krishna consciousness, the different levels of expressions of that love. So, try to speak on something that is impossible to speak of. And that's using Krishna consciousness to give you something impossible, and you gotta somehow make it possible. It's called extra mercy of the Lord. It somehow has to come and descend in order to speak something to justifiable. To just to do a small review, you have your graphs in front of you, the sheets. Those of you who didn't receive one, I got no idea yet. I think everyone got one. So the different stages are faith. When your faith begins to associate with the devotees, starts practicing Krishna consciousness, and then under the guidance of a spiritual master, but struggles with the senses, the mind, and decisions, various types of inabilities to hold
discussion is here, 10 verses before and 10 after, so you can write
yourself. What do I do? Because I'm not, you know,
Do you want to go to the beginning of discussion?
I'll find it. Okay. Yeah, that's it. It's not a Bengali, it's a Sanskrit verse, that's why.
I'm trying to switch.
Okay. So, then, when you're struggling with different things, you're working in other directions, you're struggling with false pride, sporadic endeavor, various types of attachments, and then you work through that. And then the Anarthanivritta stage is you try to clear away all these things, what they call anarthas, things that you don't want. Things that have come by association with the material energy, things that have come by being attached to material life, and things that come just by having a material body. So when one starts to struggle on that platform, anarthanivritti, and works to free themselves from all these attachments, then one starts to develop a steadiness in Krishna consciousness. Until we come to the free ourselves from at least 75% of the anarthas. There's 16 major anarthas, so 12 have to be destroyed before you can actually remain, come to the platform of Vishnu. Nishta means, even in Nishta, one will still struggle with various, let's say, anarthas, but at the same time, they have reached the platform of goodness in the execution of their devotional service. And you can't stay steady on passion, you can't, obviously, ignorance is, you know, just the most abominable mode there is. Anyone who acts still in ignorance is really hasn't made any advancement at all. Ignorance means you're just always angry, greedy, lazy, critical, like that. That's the ha! You found it. Oh, that's it. I can come by the Sanskrit. Yeah, that's the one. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's the way. Thank you.
So,
you did it. You did it. And so, yeah, we actually, are fixed. And then when that fixation becomes full, when one reaches the platform of Ruchi. Ruchi is a sweet taste. It's not, it's a sweet taste that is mostly there. It may disappear occasionally, but one is feeling happy. There's a sense of joyfulness that comes when one reaches the stage of Ruchi. One is happy. They are not morose anymore. They're only eager, they're eager to hear and chant the glories of the Lord, associate with great souls and perform devotional service. They don't want to be bothered with the full life anymore. And we talked about the symptoms of Ruchi. When one is a little bit more advanced, it doesn't matter who's singing, who's talking, or who's doing what, it doesn't matter as long as it's Krishna Katha, they like it. One who is less advanced on the Ruchi platform, they require what is called excellence of elements. The kirtan has to be sung nicely, the instruments have to be played together with them. Yesterday we had a beautiful kirtan that was made, and the excellence of elements were completely absent, but everyone was dancing like a madman. The person who was leading it is not here, that's why. Maybe he is, I guess. He's not. But he was leading it yesterday, and he couldn't sing for anything. He was the worst singer I ever heard. Not really that bad. I'm worse. But because he had so much bhakti, everybody was bouncing around like rubber balls, you know. So, it's the bhakti that is important, even though the excellence of elements, the kirtan was a little, you know, not what you say, melodious. But see, these are Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati. He used to leave kirtan and everybody looked down. He would have a terrible voice. Prabhupada said, my spiritual master, he couldn't sing. But when he would sing, everybody was in ecstasy because he was the Bhakti. I'm using that because I have a terrible voice too, so I don't have any bhakti either, so that's a problem. Double whammy. But it's the bhakti that inspires the person on the platform of Ruchi, and more than the actual immediate, what we say, glorious and perfect expression of the melodies. Of course, for preaching, Prabhupada was very strong that melody and instruments and singing should be done nicely, because he said you will never attract the Westerners unless you perform kirtan nicely. They require that. But in India, you know, maybe bang on the drum, gang, gang, bang, 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 everybody go, it's like the bells ring. Bing, bong, boom, boom, bong, boom, bang, bang, yeah. Everybody's dancing, chanting, it's like wild, you know. Indian kirtans. Supadra, I don't know if you'd fit into that one, too. So, you know, but you know, that's, I mean, in India, it's like excellence of elements is just an idea. Just start getting a little better. So, yeah, and so from that stage, then one develops attachment for Krishna. And when one becomes attached to Krishna, one laments their previous attachment to the material life, and simply wants to think of Krishna and serve Krishna completely. On the Bhava platform, the bud of the flow of God starts to flower, and beautiful leaves start to accompany that beautiful growth of that plant of bhakti, and so many embellishments of sweetness start to arise from the devotee's heart. He cries, he laughs, he sings, he dances. He sees Krishna, Krishna comes, Krishna disappears, then he cries again. These are different symptoms. Now we're going to go to prema. Watch out. Ooh. I don't know what I can say about this one. This is really, this is like, this is postgraduate stuff here. Prema inspires the devotee's consciousness. Complete disdain for any and all of one's previous attachments. Now you know, for those of you who are not sure the meaning of the word disdain, that means total disgust in the most intense way for everything material. Just to think about something material would cause the person to get sick. All material attachments enfold and shine in the nectar of transcendence. So whatever is there in the material world, now he sees everything as spiritual. Devotee's hunger is never satiated. Prema causes eagerness like a hot burning sun, yet it delivers simultaneously millions of cooling moon rays. It's a contradictory expression. Can you imagine, like, somebody made a really hot, fiery chutney, but it put a lot of sugar in it too. So the sugar is so nice, and it's nice and syrupy and sweet and juicy, and it even looks nice. But it's so full of food, and you're burning, and your ears are, and being smoke coming out of your ears, and that your eyes are turning like bright red, and the limbs of your body are burning, but it's so sweet you can't stop. And it's so hot you can't continue. That's the love of God. You ready? It's like that. One burns in the fire of Krishna's love at the same time, feels the cooling rays of Krishna's sweet glance upon your heart and mind. Eagerness for Krishna's direct association, her audience. Okay, so I made a note here. I have to read some things. Talks about the eagerness. The burning arrow of extreme eagerness lacerates him. Its intensity causes him dissatisfaction despite exalting the Supreme Lord's sublime beauty and ambrosial pastimes. His desire fuels his frustrations towards everything in general. Relationships with friends, family, and other relatives lose meaning and resemble dried up wells. His home looms ominously before him like a forest of thorny bushes, and to even eat becomes a punishment. This is love of God. Praise pains like the bite of a poisonous fang of a snake. So many praises and he feels all miserable. And his daily chores and duties take on a deathly pallor. He carries the limbs of his body like unbearable weights. His well-wishers, consolations are like cloudbursts of noxious rains. Nobody can pacify. His waking hours drown him in an ocean of repentance, and the rare moments of sleep become intolerable torment. Living becomes a burden of guilt, a censure from providence. Like scorched padding, meditations are devoid of substance. In which had earlier given him satisfaction, now lack purpose. Even remembering the Lord's lotus feet becomes an excruciating effort, and he feels as if someone was tearing him from limb to limb. You ready? Why go that far? This is love of God. One who reaches that stage can't live anymore. There's no reason to stay in this world. But somehow Krishna allows him to stay a little more just to intensify that love even more. Because the mood of separation increases these different symptoms of loving ecstasy, where it gets so unbearable that finally Krishna just takes the person back to his lotus feet. And then one looks back at this material world as just a bad dream. So, Hare Krishna. He can't function. Lord Chaitanya, I mentioned yesterday, Lord Chaitanya, someone said to Lord Chaitanya, "My dear Lord, you have so much love for Krishna." Lord Chaitanya said, "I have no love for Krishna. If I had any love for Krishna, I wouldn't be maintaining this body anymore." So these are symptoms of love. Now don't try to imitate them. You can't, because if you do, you will fall down. These things develop naturally through the process of bhakti. They can't be There is a class of people who try to artificially imitate these. They're called sahajis. They pretentiously adopt certain symptoms of love of God and display them in public, trying to convince themselves and others that they have received that level of bhakti. They roll on the ground. One time there was one person rolling on the ground by our Krishna Balaram temple, and the boys came and told Prabhupada, "Prabhupada, said, go over there and kick him." So he kicked him and the guy got up and ran away. Another time the same thing happened. Prabhupada just let it go, and then finally he got up and wiped the dust of Vrindavan off his clothes and lit up a cigarette and left. There's nobody was paying attention to him. So there are a class of people who are called sahajiya. Sahajiya means one who takes something cheaply. It's the actual translation, which means that if you have something that is valuable and you cheapen it by not taking it properly or misusing it or abusing it, that's the definition of sahajiya. You know, you can't give up a valuable jewel to a little child, he'll just roll it on the ground and he doesn't know what it is, or put it in his mouth and suck on it. So in the same way, sahajiya means one who is trying to imitate something that is, very much the treasure of life, love of God. Through prema, one can see the Lord. In later stages, this attracts Krishna. Krishna reveals himself to his pure devotee in many of his attributes and qualities. I wrote down an analogy of the traveler in the desert. Traveler in the desert. What would that analogy be? In many attributes and qualities of a traveler in the desert. Oh, a traveler in the desert means he's suffering. There's no place to stay, hot burning sun, there's no water. But then when Krishna appears as the oasis, that refreshing, cooling water that quenches his thirst and gives him such happiness and satisfaction. So Krishna will appear to the devotee in prema and make him feel happy. But then Krishna leaves. It's one thing about Krishna, he doesn't stay long anywhere. He just keeps moving. Unless you're a fast runner, you can't keep up with him. Even if you are, you still can't. He just keeps moving. I got him. Where did he go? Just gone. Krishna first reveals himself through his beautiful form. So for a person in praying, his beautiful transcendental form, which attracts the minds of all of us. We are attracted mostly to Krishna by his beauty, right? Mostly. His beauty is what attracts our eyes and then also inspires our heart. Devotees reach unbearable ecstasy and lose consciousness simply to seeing his beauty. Krishna then exudes his transcendental fragrance, and then the devotee loses consciousness again. And it's really good. See, Krishna reveals his beautiful form. The devotee relishes the beauty of that form. His eyes become enchanted. His heart becomes mesmerized, and then he faints. And then when he gets up, he's back to consciousness again. Krishna lets loose his beautiful transcendental fragrance. His fragrance is so sweet. It's described in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. It's a combination of anguru, musk, camphor, what else? Another would be
sandalwood.
I can't understand Croatian. Can you speak in English?
Sandalwood.
Sandalwood. Oh, okay. Sandalwood. Yeah, it's also there. Sandalwood. Yeah, there's one more. I can give you. Maybe it's camphor. I didn't mention camphor and musk. It's so sweet that it's unbearably sweet. Blue lotus. The fragrance of a blue lotus. Yeah. That's his good. Yeah, it's there also. But that fragrance has these different ingredients combined together. So after his nostrils become enchanted with Krishna's fragrance, he again loses consciousness. Then Krishna rescues him with his melodious voice. And then Krishna speaks reassuring words of love. And again, he loses consciousness. Going in and out of consciousness. According to the devotee, rasa with Krishna, Krishna takes the devotee into his personal touch. In Madhurya love, the intimacy increases. The devotee swoons over and over again. The Adaya appears, and the devotee can relish unhindered all the Lord's transcendental qualities. And then the Lord puts it all together and reveals his majesty of all his opulence simultaneously. You can imagine what's happened to the poor guy. He's suffering by Krishna. You can die out of too much love, you know? If you suffer too much, you can die. You can also die of too much happiness. This is what happens. But it doesn't take you to the point of death, you just lose consciousness. So Krishna preserves your existence in that body for a longer time. And then Krishna does something. He shows his compassion and mercy, which is the seventh opulence, anugraha. The devotee feels peaceful with Krishna after putting him through all these ecstatic symptoms of his, based on his bodily qualities. Then Krishna shows him some compassion and mercy, and the devotee feels happy. Do we have a Srimad Bhagavatam, 1st Canto, 16th chapter here? Turn to verse 26. Now, there are 18 faults that overcome the conditioned soul. 1:16:26. Okay? These are, I'm going to read some of the qualities of the Lord. 26. So this is a series of idle verses in one. Krishna, these qualities reside in Krishna. Truthfulness, cleanliness, intolerance of another's unhappiness. Krishna is so kind that he incarnates in every species of life. All 8,400,000 species of life, Krishna is there. So be careful when you look on the floor, you might see a cockroach. If he has a peacock feather, don't step on it. And all the species of life. Why does he do that? Because that species gets attracted to that particular species that is Krishna within their own species, and by that attraction, that soul within that, those species become automatically elevated to a higher stage of existence. It doesn't really explain, but I would assume they go right to the human form of life. So Krishna does that. He just to show his love for his parts and parcels. He incarnates in every species of life. 8,400,000. Another quality of Krishna is the power to control anger. He's self-satisfied, he's straightforward, he's steady in mind. He controls his senses, responsible, he's equal to all, tolerant, he has equanimity, faithfulness, knowledge, absence of sense, enjoyment, leadership, chivalry, influence, the power to make everything possible. He discharges his duty, complete independence, dexterity, fullness of beauty, serenity, kindheartedness, ingenuity, gentility, magnanimity, determination, perfection in all knowledge, proper execution, possession of all objects of enjoyment, joyfulness, immovability, fidelity, fame, worship, pridelessness, being as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, eternity, and many other transcendental qualities which are eternally present in him and never separated from him. He's the reservoir of all goodness and all beauty. Now he's appeared on this earth during the age of Kali. That's Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Okay. So these are some qualities of Krishna. Any comments on any of those qualities? I know I read the questions. Okay, now this section also talks about the 18 faults. These are the 18 faults that cover the conditioned soul. You ready to hear about your faults? Of course, I shouldn't think you all have faults, but I'm just talking generally. Okay, you're an illusion. Sleepiness. Mara's giving class again, time to take rest. Uncivility. That one fits me. Lust, greed, madness, envy, cruelty, limitation, over-endeavor, deceit, anger, desire, fear, mistakes, intolerance, dependence, and untruth. 18 qualities of the conditioned souls. 18 faults. All of these become transformed into divine qualities on the platform of prayer. So all these qualities actually attain perfection. The Prema Bhakti delights in all the Lord's divine opulences, and he strongly feels the protective love of the Lord. The Lord feels indebted to his devotee for tolerating so many difficulties and disturbances in order to serve him. And the loving Lord wants to offer everything to his devotee, but he cannot think of anything to offer, so he desires to offer himself. He told that to the devotees. I cannot repay your love. There's no way I can. You have to be satisfied with the happiness that comes from your own love. I cannot give you anything. I don't have to, I'm not qualified to reciprocate the love you offer me. That's how grateful Krishna is. He never thinks that, you know, he's so great. He sees his devotee actually being greater than him because the devotee has such love in Krishna. Therefore, it attracts Krishna's mind and heart. The Lord reciprocates the devotee's love. The Lord reveals Sri Vrindavan to his loving devotee who sees Krishna in Vrindavan along with his eternal associates. So this is described that actually Krishna reveals himself as Vrajendra Nandana of Vrindavan, and then the devotee enters into a vision. And in that vision he sees Krishna in Vrindavan playing with his friends, playing with his girlfriends. He sees Mother Yasoda, he sees Nanda Maharaj, he sees the cows, he sees Krishna milking the cows. He actually enters into the spiritual world through a transcendental, a trance of vision, and then he becomes overwhelmed with loving emotion, and then it all disappears. Then he feels totally unhappy. So these are symptoms of love of God. Back and forth, waves of happiness, lamentation, hankering for the Lord to reappear, ecstatic symptoms, completely captivate his body and mind. Hope and hopelessness, he neglects his body, he no longer wants to stay in the material world. And then finally Krishna takes him back and he attains his Siddhadeva, his spiritual body, in the spiritual world with Krishna. Something to look forward to. And so there are different stages of prema, sneha, when the heart melts with excessive love. You can stop me and we can discuss some of these. Mala, extreme affection that uncovers new delightful regions of loving and exchange, making the beloved externally behave in a capricious way. Pranaya, a type of mana that induces the beloved to feel on equal terms with the lover, thus bringing about quarrels of love between them. So one actually comes to the stage of feeling equal with Krishna, and then there's a love or a quarrel. Krishna, why did you leave me? And Krishna said, that's something to do. No, you just make an excuse. Devotee argues with Krishna. Loveless quarrel. Raga, conflicting emotions in the beloved, sometimes unbearable lamentation, and sometimes extreme happiness, while waiting expectantly to meet our lover of Krishna. Raga, that love that makes the beloved experience her old lover as if meeting him for the first time. We already had an association with Krishna in the spiritual world. He completely forgot that. Now, again, it's revived. And of course, the highest stage of love, which is practically impossible for the conditioned souls to attain, Mahabhava, says that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Radharani, and Mother Vendrapuri are the only persons who have attained that stage of Mahabhava. Because it says no fourth person has attained that stage. It's the highest. The highest expression of love with all its diversity and complexity. This is not found in any other loving exchanges. It makes it sound like it's available to us, but the Shastras say that it's practically impossible to reach that level. But it may be once you return to the spiritual world. Any questions on love of God? I know it's a little hard. Yes?
So if Govinda Maharaj left the body in this stage.
She's talking about the disappearance of Govinda Maharaj. His disappearance was quite extraordinary. He was He was reading, reading or talking, I think he was talking, maybe reading and talking, to a small group of devotees in his room in Mayapur. It was on the appearance day of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. I was there in Mayapur at the time.
I was next to his room
again. You were there?
Outside his room.
You were outside the room. Really? I see. And at one point in talking about Krishna's return to Vrindavan, I think it was, how Krishna, you know, was feeling so much separation from the residents of Vrindavan that on the three other residents he returned, and that's called Ratha Yatra, of course. When Maharaj got to that point, he just started to become overwhelmed with love. And his eyes closed, and he stopped speaking. So the devotees, many of the devotees knew he used to go into trances many times. But this time he went into a trance and never came out. He simply left his body at that point. This morning, he was just reading and talking about Krishna, and he just went into ecstasy and disappeared. It's quite miraculous, amazing. Then we all understood, because many of us understood the quality of his devotion, but we didn't really experience, understand it to the level he had attained. Did you see me there? I was there. I came to the room later.
I was outside the room, and one devotee was very screaming, where is my Gurudev? Two brahmacharis were tearing him out. And then I went to inform Prabhupada Maharaj to come.
They all came.
Ishani Mataji, she brought Mahagaland and philosophies. And
I couldn't get into the room, it was too crowded by the time I arrived. I was in the Gurukul.
I didn't dare to enter.
Huh?
I didn't dare to enter inside.
I wanted to, but I couldn't get in. Yeah, he just, talking about Krishna, just disappeared. When Prabhupada first met her, he gave her first, second, and third initiation all in one ceremony. Three initiations all at once. First, second, sannyas. Everything in one. He met Prabhupada when he was 45 years old. He traveled around the world. He had a hard time in Western countries. He couldn't understand how the Western countries are actually able to exist. They were so sinful. He was a really elevated personality. Amazing. Yeah, that was really good. Thank you for bringing that up. Yeah, that was. What year was it? 1996. Yeah, it was the centennial year. Yeah. It's the centennial year, 1996. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati's appearance day. He left the world. Really auspicious. During the time when all the leaders were there, it was during the GBC meetings. I was in the Gurukul listening to Atmatattva speak on various pastimes of Krishna. When the word came and we all immediately randomized. To get from the Gurukul to where he was a long way. So we ran there. Yeah, there are many great souls in this movement. Prabhupada said that Gaura Chaitanya, many of the devotees in this movement are song servants and associates of Gaura Chaitanya coming in to help Prabhupada spread Krishna consciousness around the world. Okay, let's see. Here's a verse here I wanted to read on page 59. When a person is actually advanced and takes pleasure in chanting the holy name of the Lord, he's very dear to him. He is agitated and loudly chants the holy name. He also laughs, cries, becomes agitated, and chants just like a madman, not caring for outsiders. I firmly believe in these words of my spiritual master, and therefore I always chant the holy name of the Lord, alone and in the association of the devotees. That holy name of Lord Krishna sometimes is causing me to chant and dance, therefore I chant and dance. Please do not think that I intentionally do it, I do it automatically. When Chaitanya is talking to Prabhu Sananda Saraswati. Okay, I thought I'd just read that verse. It's really a beautiful verse. Any questions? Love of God. You have to ask him that. it's a symptom of love. When someone loves you and they please you so greatly, you think, I can't do anything to them. You're a reciprocate. You've given me so much and I can't give you as much as you give me. That's what Krishna's feeling. You give me so much, but I'm unable to reciprocate on the same level of what you give me. These are symptoms of love, that's all. That happens even in ordinary life. A person that feels indebted to another person feels like they're inadequate to repay back what that person has given them. These are symptoms of affection for that person, that's all. Gratitude, affection, appreciation, humility. A humble person doesn't think themselves able to do anything. So Krishna also exhibits humility. It's one of his qualities. See, it's dangerous to go into this subject too much, then you won't be able to function. You can't do anything. You'll forget about eating, you'll forget about sleeping, you'll forget about taking care of the kids. And give up everything. It's dangerous. You know, these things. What's the use of anything in this world? But sometimes, you know, devotees also feel like that. What am I wasting my time doing all these other things for? I should just simply be chanting the holy names all the time and associating with devotees. But you can't stay on that platform. The symptoms of love of God can be expressed practically on every stage of devotion, but symptomatics, not all the symptoms, but some symptoms, may manifest even on the platform of Nishtha. But these are just flashes, they come and go. On love of God, these various types of symptoms and expressions and experiences are constantly happening, one after another. And in one instance, in nectar devotion, one of the ecstatic symptoms is called death. Yeah, it's mentioned. There's many ecstatic symptoms. One of them is called death.
We just came to this chapter in morning session.
You did?
Tomorrow we are in.
Oh, okay, good. That's appropriate. Radharani, he says to Krishna, Krishna, you know, she's talking to the wind because Krishna's not there. He says, Krishna, you're like an agricultural person who keeps animals. And you lock those animals inside of the house. And you take the key and you leave the key. Now the house is on fire. And the animals are screaming in pain inside the fire of the blazing house. But they can't get out because they are suffering the fire because the door is locked. And she says to Krishna, I would immediately die, but I can't because you locked the key for me getting out of this body by saying, I will return. This expression of bhakti. I will return. She said, because you said, I will return, that keeps me alive. Otherwise, there's no purpose in my existence. Anyway, we're going into some place. And these things are there in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Chaitanya Charitamrita is the first Adi Leela's all philosophy. It's mostly philosophy establishing the tattva, a guru establishing the tattva of Nityananda, Balaram, Advaita, also Chaitanya Mahaprabhu talks about his early pastimes as a young boy. It puts everything in perspective. Who is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? What is his tattva? The second, Madhya Leela is all is mostly that tattva is being played out in various leelas. In the last stage, it's all about love of God. The Lord Chaitanya goes into the mood of Radharani and exhibits some of his ecstatic symptoms. The sweetness of Krishna's body, the beauty of Krishna's body, separation from Krishna, living at the Gandhara. All these things are part of the last part. So Chaitanya Charitamrita starts with Tattva, Leela, and then Supreme Leela in the ecstasy of Lord Chaitanya's separation from Krishna and Guru Radharani. It's the highest religious scripture that is available in terms of the subject matters that it deals with. Okay. I know it's hard to ask questions on this, but unless you do, sleep. One of the symptoms of ecstasy is sleep. Yes.
I have one question regarding the Manvendra Puri. Is he the person actually who kind of opened the, I mean, Jagat Mahaprabhu brought the love of God, and I mean, that he opened the gate of the full love of God, but it was not manifested. Is that true?
Manvendra Puri brought it in, actually. He is called, is a term that's used to refer to him. He brought the love of God because he introduced Radharani into the process of bhakti. Before, Radharani wasn't known. It's Madhavendra Puri. And Lord Chaitanya's, you know, spiritual master was the disciple of Radharani, Vishwara Puri. So there's a connection between Radharani and Lord Chaitanya. It's coming in the Sampradaya of Madhavendra Puri. Madhavendra Puri, his identity is that he's an eternal associate in the spiritual world. He's a Kalpa Viksha tree. Those trees that when you can go in the spiritual world, you ask anything from that tree will provide whatever you want. Prabhupada said, in this world, each tree may be able to give you something. But in the spiritual world, there are types of trees that if you approach them and request anything, they will give whatever you request. You call desire trees, chintamani trees, or Kalpa Viksha. So Madhavendra Puri's actual identity, he is one of those trees in the spiritual world. That's why it says that, you know, well, no fourth person had the level of bhakti that Madhavendra Puri had, except for Lord Chaitanya and Radharani. He's a very exalted personality. You can't understand his level of bhakti. He's on, not only on the level of God, he's on the highest platform. Yeah. So he's the one that brought the worship of Radha into the Sampradaya.
And sometimes we consider that Radharani is not prominent or is hidden, like in the Radharaman temple. I mean, she's there, but...
She's there, but we can't see her. Yeah, it's like that. That's why we don't speak of Radharani too much, because it's such a confidential subject matter. We talk about Krishna all the time, but we don't speak so much about Radharani. Because it's impossible to speak about her properly. You just commit offenses if you try to speak about her. That's just the way it is. She's too exalted to speak about. We pray to her. And we honor her on her appearance day, but we can't glorify her. We can read about those great souls who write about her glories, but Radha Bhakti is the highest. It's higher than Krishna Bhakti. There's somebody higher than Krishna. Best, to use a small word.
We take, she's best in everything, but we take service. She's best in service, so we take her as a sample.
Yeah. Prabhupada writes that song, Radha, what is it? That only when Radharani becomes pleased with you, then only will your devotional service have reached success. So, she's very compassionate though. That's her nature. She's very compassionate. So we worship her in her compassion mantra, the mood of compassion. She goes, she always tries to make arrangements for others to meet Krishna. The Prabhupada is a very interesting little statement. He said, on Janmasthami we fast to midnight, and on Rajasthami we fast half a day. So who's more compassionate? Sukadeva Goswami didn't even mention her name in the Bhagavatam. He refers to Aradhananda, that person who has the topmost worship. There's two reasons why he didn't mention it. The one reason we know is that because if he did mention it, he would have went into ecstasy and would not have been able to complete his narration. So to avoid losing consciousness and continuing with his service, he didn't mention her name, although he referred to her in this one verse. The other one is that Sukadeva Goswami was sitting amongst many sages and saints. Not only Maharaj Pariksit, but there were sages and saints who came from all over the universe. And he understood their quality of bhakti wasn't to the level where they could hear about Radharani. So that's another reason it's mentioned that he didn't speak, because they weren't able to understand, or weren't qualified to understand, they didn't have the adhikari to understand. It's only by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy that you can understand anything about Radha Krishna. Without Mahaprabhu's mercy, there's no chance. You can't even touch Vrindavan. It's all coming through the mercy of Lord Chaitanya. So therefore we approach Vrindavan through Gaura. What's the word? Gaura-lila, Gaura-guidance, Gaura-gaura, and Gaura, everything is Gaura for us. Lord Chaitanya is everything. It says that in order to get Krishna's mercy, you have to get Radha's mercy. In order to get Radha's mercy, you have to get Mahaprabhu's mercy. In order to get Mahaprabhu's mercy, you have to get Nityananda's mercy. In order to get Nityananda's mercy, you have to get your Guru's mercy, who is an embodiment of your mercy for Nityananda. So when through your Guru's mercy, he brings you to Nityananda's mercy. What is Nityananda's mercy? Is that he engages you nicely in chanting the holy names of the Lord. When one becomes fixed in chanting the holy names of the Lord and develops a sweet taste for chanting, Mahaprabhu becomes satisfied and introduces you to Vrindavan. Only when you develop a taste for chanting of the holy names of the Lord can you actually begin to approach Vrindavan. If we don't have that taste, there's no chance to approach Vrindavan. The holy name is the embodiment of Sri Vrindavan down in the stage. And then Radharani takes you, but she doesn't deal with you directly, she sends her manjaris to deal with you. And brings you into the Lord of Vrindavan. And gradually you learn the art of serving in one of the various rasas, the higher rasas either. Friendship, parental affection, or conjugal love. And then you're trained under the guidance of someone, one of the associates there, and gradually you enter into a particular group, and then you start serving in that group as an assistant to those who are assistants to Radha and Krishna. Or if you're a counterpoint, you also enter in the same way. There's a story. Arjuna, the warrior, wanted to understand Krishna's pastimes in Vrindavan. He was talking to Krishna. Krishna just laughed. He says, "You?" And Arjuna was serious. What is the Gopi's love for you like? Can you explain it? Krishna knew he couldn't explain it. All he could do was do something. So what he did is he created a situation where Arjuna was transformed into a Gopi. There's one Gopi, it's called Arjuna Gopi. It's mentioned. And then there's a whole pastime where he's put under the guidance of someone. And they say, who's this Gopi? We never met him before. Where are you from? Where's your village? A new girl on the block. And then he's there with his, I think he's got his bow, you know. Anyway, then he finally gets to experience in the mood of a luxury, you know, what it's like for the Duryodhana. So Krishna can do that. He can allow you to change your rasa, but that's very rare. Lakshmi tried, and she couldn't do it. Lakshmi tried to get into Vrindavan, she wasn't able to get into Vrindavan. She performed all the austerities, became qualified, but there's one disqualification that caused her not to enter, and that was that she couldn't give up her understanding of Lakshmi, and being Lakshmi. And Lakshmi is awe and reverence. I mean, there's no awe and reverence in Vrindavan. Krishna doesn't like that stuff. That's for Vaikuntha. So she couldn't get in. Shiva, he also wanted to get in. And he performed austerities. And he transformed himself into, he came into Vrindavan. And then he met Lalita. And Lalita asked him, what are you doing here? I want to be one of the gopis in the rasa dance. So I'm going to dance with Krishna. You, Shiva? Okay. See that pond over there? Take a bath in that pond. Immerse yourself completely. So he did it. He came out and he was a little girl. With a moon on his head, he still had his moon, you know. And then Krishna saw, ooh, it's funny movie. Krishna started to laugh. And then he realized it was Shiva. And he said, Shiva, now you can't come in. But you can do one thing. I'll give you some service. You can guard the dance. So he did what he was called Dikpala. He guarded the rasa dance from any intruders that would disturb the Krishna's pastimes. So he couldn't come in directly. It says that when the Krishna dances the rasa dance, the demigods come to watch, but all they can see is the. Let me see how this is explained. They can see the gopis, but they can't see Krishna in the rasa dance because they're not qualified to see Krishna in that lila. The wise are a little more advanced. They can see more. There's different levels of rasa dance. Krishna has this supreme rasa dance, and sometimes he does these sub rasa dances just to keep, you know, things moving along. So, has anybody read Shiva Maharaj's book? That 8 volumes, Raga? And nobody? All these pastimes are there. It's just one pastime after another. He's actually performed a miracle with that book. He's taken all of Krishna Leelas and put it together from all sources, all the great sadhus, goswamis, saints, writings from various scriptures. He's put it all together and it's an amazing compilation of Krishna Leela. Of course, we can read what Prabhupada has given us also. The 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. This is the only way you can do it. It's not possible, and I was just hearing this yesterday, it's not possible to love Krishna unless you hear about him regularly. Only by hearing about him regularly, your love will develop. You can't just say, well, I'll just love Krishna. You might show some affection from time to time, but that love will never come to actually enter into his leelas through the process of hearing about him regularly. And if you hear about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that's also a little Krishna leela too. But Krishna leela is a little bit more confidential. So we have our leelas in this world too, right? It's called Alila. I mean, you look at your life in this world, it's simply we're trying to perform what is going on in the spiritual world here. It's the same thing. Prabhupada said this is a perverted reflection of the reality. All the men want to be Krishna, all the women want to be Radharani. But there, it's a bad show. It's really a bad show. It's like nobody was cast for the part, and nobody knows exactly how to play the part yet. So this material world is a reflection of the reality. And every man wants to be worshipped by ladies, and all the ladies want to have joy in all men. Like, this is called, you know, Bhumi Leela or something. And, you know, but you know, you don't have the same fragrance as Krishna. In fact, you have another fragrance that is not so nice. That's why you have to use colognes and perfumes and all these anti-stink medicines, right? Because the body is bad and it smells terrible. Do you think I'm so fragrant because I bought this cologne? You know, your feet smell. The armpits are not so nice either. The nose has so many wonderful things in it. It's just like, you know, it's a bad show. And everybody's going to be Radha and Krishna. It's not even close, you know. And the men try to have more than one Radharani, so they go to other gopis. And the Radharani gets mad. I'm your wife. What are you going to somebody else for? Well, this is just natural. That's what Krishna does. And you have these kids that look like you. I always wanted some successor to my existence, and you get a little kid who looks just like you. Gee, you look at yourself in the form of a kid. It's really kind of funny. And the kid grows up in a kid, and then he leaves you. Takes all your money. This is, and the legalism in this world is just like this mortifying. It's just a joke. This world is a bad joke. It's everybody's trying to play the game like it's okay. You know? Krishna doesn't work, but you have to work in order to make it through some level of practicing Krishna. you know, effectively. Krishna's full of all happiness, but you got to go out and make money so you can be Bhagavan in some form. I got some money. Somebody hands you some paper and you think you're rich. This place is ridiculous. It's totally ridiculous. You go to work for somebody who doesn't like you. You have to kind of like offer obeisances to him and all this, make sure he likes you so you get your paycheck and doesn't fire you. This is one joke after another. And then you die. It's all over. It closes. Next drama. This was another drama. More like a comedy. Satire. More like a satire. You think it's real? It's like when you go into these fun houses, you look in the mirror gets like big, and so you see you're like fat, and then you're real skinny, and then your face goes. You're trying to get fat, you're trying to lose weight. You're just trying to lose weight. You can't see his feet because he's so fat, you know, his belly's like, he looks down, where's my It's really a hilarious place. It's the only way you can look at this place, because if you take it seriously, you're in trouble. Then it's Valentine's Day. Give you my heart. I love you, but I know you'd love somebody else, but still I love you. It's part of our leelas. This is a riot. Prabhupada came and saved us from all this craziness. Get a job. Oh my God, that's like, it's like being beaten with hammers. Get a job. Oh my God. Can't believe it working. Nobody likes to work, right? If you look at kids, they just play all the time. Because that's the nature of a child, likes to play. When we grow up, we go, I don't gotta work. When I grow up, I was like, oh man, I don't want to grow up. I gotta go work. I don't want to go to work. And I'm just thinking, I always had to get out of work. How to get out of this thing called work. I never liked it. And there was a TV show when I was growing up. There was this guy, and when you said work, he would jump and he'd get scared and just say the word work. It's all play in the spiritual world. That's all it is. But it's full of variety. Like here, there's variety too. But not like in the spiritual world. There's endless variety in the spiritual world. So, because we really don't have much information or don't hear enough about the spiritual world, we just think, does it really exist? Is it actually true there is a spiritual world? Seems so far removed from our existence. It is very far, both in distance and in our ability to conceive of such things. Shastras are our only, they're the windows into the reality. There's one girl in London, wonderful devotee. She was a brahmachari in her last life in Scotland. And she died in an armed automobile crash. She came back as a Mataji in this life. She was a real nice devotee. Really, now she's dedicated her whole life to Sankirtan. She's on Sankirtan 24/7. She's out every day on the streets. She's joined a group of devotees. But she knows her last life. She was a brahmachari. So, you know, so one life for a brahmachari, and then the next life for a mataji. So which one is the real life? Oh, I'm a mataji now, so that's what really counts. What were you before? So it's like you're going through these different dresses. You change dress. So we change bodies life after life after life. You get a new body. A woman gets attached to a man and she dies, she takes a man's body. A man gets attached to a woman, he gets to a goddess, takes a woman's body. So you get different bodies. You're the same person. But we think this body is me. I'm a Mataji. I'm a Prabhuji. It's like, okay, you gotta play the part, and that's obvious. But don't get too absorbed in the part you play, because you're gonna have to play in other parts again, change roles again. This world is just like that. Prabhupada, and the Shastra said, this world was created because we allow you to leave Krishna. Okay, so here it is. This is the show. If you want to go, create your own show. You never know. You might go real slow. And then it's a lot of woe. So stay away, Joe, from the world of no-go. So this place is crazy. That's Brahma and Prabhupada wrote that famous little treatise. When people used to see us on the streets in the early days in America, they never saw anything like it. Bald heads with these little ponytails, with flowing orange robes, white robes. They were looking at us, what is this, somebody from another planet? Really? And you see, say that, these people, Martians, or and then Prabhupada, and then they would say, these people are crazy, they would call us crazy. And Prabhupada wrote a response, because people kept saying, over and over again, you guys are crazy. So Prabhupada wrote a response, and the response was, who is crazy? The pamphlet's still available, you probably see it. And Prabhupada wrote a kind of a rhetorical discussion. We say you are crazy, and you say we are crazy. So let's discuss. So the conclusion was, one who doesn't know who he is, that's the sign of insanity. So if you think you're this body, you're crazy. It's not you. I don't like it. It's better if you don't like it, then it's easier not thinking of it as you. If you got a beautiful body and it's got all kinds of nice contours and shapes and so many wonderful things about it, you might think, Hare Krishna is a little fanatical. You don't understand that my body's the better one. People think we're fanatics, right? We preach, like, you guys preach, and you speak so. We just criticize everything in this world. Say something good. They used to say that to us all the time. Yeah, something good is that you're not this body. You're Krishna's part and parcel. So, yeah. So we end here? Okay, now you have to feed this body, it's called prasadam. That's okay, that's a spiritual act, it's not a material act. And you can, and the thing is, prasadam is enjoyable. So, as we say, enjoy prasadam. Because when you take prasadam, you're becoming spiritually purified, and you're satisfying your spiritual senses. The mind becomes happy and peaceful, and then you can engage nicely in devotional service. If you simply take prasadam and don't do any service, then your prasadam seva has not, doesn't have much value. Prasadam is an impetus for seva. It's one of the biggest impetus. Right? That's mentioned after devotion. By eating prasadam, we get inspired to serve. Okay. Anything else? Love of material world? Oh, I'm sorry. Love of God?
Is this clapping of hands is like a symptom of ecstasy?
Huh? Like this?
Clapping, yeah. Maybe laughing.
Oh, when I'm laughing, I clap? And this is the show that...
We
all do that, yeah. It's just,
I think it's mentioned somewhere.
Yeah. Laughing is a symptom of ecstasy. It's called, and there's also a sub-ras called Hashyaras. Hashyaras. Hashya means laughter, and then there's six ways to express it. You start with a small smile, it gets bigger, and it's a full smile, then all the senses start jumping in, and then pretty soon you're up in the air. There's six ways to express happiness in the form of laughter as the sub-ras in Krishna consciousness. Hashya rasa. Not hasti, hashya. Hasti is elephant. Hashya rasa. Laughter. There's one thing I like about Croatia. You guys laugh. Some places you tell me over there. Rita Anamara, she's so funny. Have you ever listened to his little talks? He was telling me one time, when he used to give classes a lot in this country, the whole class would roar in laughter. I mean, the whole time. So one time he was in Boston Temple, and Prabhupada was also there. And he gave a class, and it was just, the devotees were just cracking up and roaring and laughing. Because he's witty. He's so intelligent that his intelligence connects with the philosophy, and he makes it so funny. But it's actually spiritually correct, too. So this class had everybody roaring and laughing. So it's over, he's walking out, and he's walking, and Prabhupada's walking right towards him, and Prabhupada looks really grave. No smile on Prabhupada's face. And then Prabhupada comes right up to him, and he stops, and he looks at him. Vidyananda Maharaj, he said, "It's good you make the devotees laugh." And Prabhupada smiled and kept walking. If you don't laugh, you'll die early. Longevity of life depends on happiness. The more happy you are, the longer you'll live. Yeah. Miserable people die young. So, of course, laughter has to have some substance to it, and not just laughter. I know one person, every time he talks, he laughs. Everything he says, he laughs. But it's good, it's kind of a cheerful mood, but some of the things he says are not funny, so it doesn't fit. It's just like we want to say, calm down, you know, laugh, but only accordingly, not accordingly. So, yeah. was it? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very funny. He wouldn't joke in public, but he would joke with his devotees. When he was with his devotees together, he would say he was always telling jokes. But now he wouldn't do it so much in public. In fact, not at all in public. Mahaprabhu was really funny. Prabhupada is also really funny. Prabhupada is so funny. And he talks about the scientists. He smashes them to pieces. So funny. Excuse me, I listened to his morning walk conversations. He's just smashing. It's just so funny. Some people get scared. People sometimes used to say, well, why does your guru want to smash everything? Because he wanted to teach us. Because we were so attached to the ways that we grew up with. Prabhupada was just trying to clear all that out so he can really give us a clear understanding of what is the reality. So sometimes strong measures are needed to get to the root. The more severe the attachment, the more, we say, stronger the medicine of study. And that's what Prabhupada was so funny. I'd like to talk about Prabhupada. Tonight maybe we'll talk about Prabhupada. I just think Sunday peace fresh. It's probably the best subject. Okay, so I should let you all take breakfast. We're supposed to be back here at 11:30 for questions and answers. I hope it's a little bit more lively than maybe after breakfast anybody will be fired up. There are some questions. And Prushana has a way of transforming everything. Thank you. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.